Hi everyone, I'm Rob from CoreOS, and today I want to talk about our journey to Giphy. So you got a great overview of Kubernetes, and that's one of the pieces of Giphy, which is Google's infrastructure for everybody else. That's a mouthful to say, so we just say Giphy. And I'm going to talk through the journey of why CoreOS has made the products that it's made, because when like we're talking about the config map from earlier, it's very easy just to say, oh, we just need a place to store this. Well, we invented that place to store it based on a lot of best practices from the industry, but you know, someone's got to make that stuff. And we make it in areas where we see white space, where there's not an existing open source solution, or not a kind of cloud native solution, we jump in and make that stuff. And I'm going to kind of talk through our journey of how we got there. So the mission at CoreOS is a very broad and hard goal. We want to secure the internet. And this is something that's deep in our core. We try to do everything very securely. And we've been thinking about ways that this has to happen. And we need to make a lot of changes to make it happen. This is kind of what our Giphy stack looks like. And I'm going to talk about some more of this in detail. But you have an operating system, cluster management solution, consistent key value store, container runtimes, and that's kind of, you can put those all together to make Giphy. And we think there's three main things that need to change to secure the internet. And we're going to actually chop that goal in half. We're going to say secure the back end of the internet. The front end of the internet, which I'm going to talk about in a second, has had this renaissance in the past decade. And so it's pretty secure, but it didn't used to be. So the first thing is Linux at scale. Managing machines at 100 node, 1,000 node, 10,000 node clusters is just kind of broken. And there's a lot of reasons for this, and we've made some strides with like configuration management and infrastructure as code. But we stepped in and we saw some problems that we wanted to solve. And that really meant changing the way that Linux works, the way that the operating system actually functions, and so we made some changes there. The second is clustering. So you're going to have your 100 nodes, your 1,000 nodes, your 10,000 nodes, but they're not really useful unless they can talk to each other. You want them to resiliently handle failure, that type of stuff. And then application packaging. This is what you're all familiar with, containers. You know, the RPN and devs that you produce, you know, they don't encapsulate the execution environment and all the dependencies. And so that's kind of the building block that all this is based on. So when we're talking about Giphy and the road to Giphy, first we have to look at Google. They invented all this stuff. They've been doing it for you know, a decade or more. And so we've looked at a number of different projects. Borg and Omega, obviously, for clustering solutions. This is kind of the best in class, best in breed. And then some of the other things that you've maybe heard of, but you haven't really looked into how they work, like Chrome OS. So this is the Linux that is shipping millions of devices. They're remotely managed. It actually very much resembles a server kind of use case, but it's for a consumer laptop. And so we've taken some interesting decisions that they've made and applied that to the back-end servers. And then the last is Chubby, which is Google's internal key value store that backs Borg. And there's no open source version of that, so we had to invent one. The other group of folks outside of Google that are doing some of this work and that we can look to for inspiration are the big web companies, Twitter's, Facebook's, you know, eBay, those type of folks, Yahoo. They've been running this type of infrastructure for a pretty long time, and you know, they're battle tested. They have a lot of good ideas, and so we've drawn some of those in as well. And then looking to the consumer side, the iOS and Android ecosystems. When you think of somebody that's running some type of Linux or Linux-like operating system and shipping around different applications and with high security, they're doing it right now. They're doing it millions of times a day across millions of devices. So there's probably some lessons we can learn from that as well. So the first thing, let's talk about Linux at scale. The core problem here is that, and especially for security, is that the OS and the kernel are very hard to patch, to manage, to keep up to date. And this, you see this in two different scales. On the small scale, you know, you have like five machines, maybe at down to the level of like a doctor's office or something like that. And really state of the art here is set it and forget it. You put it in a closet, it's up and running, you have some contractor come in and do something. And then, you know, it's just safer to just never touch it again. And that's a shame. And this is partly because those folks are not competent in security just because they don't have a security team. They don't have the resources. It's like it's something that's core to their business, but it's not core enough for them to like have that on site. And so that's kind of on the small scale, that's a problem. On the large scale, you do have a team of security experts or operations folks, but you don't really have the tools that you need to run this stuff. So if you're going to update an operating system on 10,000 machines, what are you going to do? There are some solutions, some good, some bad. Some work for some organizations, but not others. And so we put some thought into that. And then your support matrix really gets blown up when you're talking about diverse hardware. Are you running on two or three clouds, or cloud and bare metal, and then plus different operating systems or different kernel versions? It becomes very hard, and so we tried to tackle that issue as well. So I mentioned we want to secure the back end of the internet. Well, we've already secured the front end of the internet, and we use some pretty novel ways to do it. So if you remember back in the day, when Internet Explorer was the king of the web, and the web was a great place, but there were also all these exploits, a ton of drive-by attacks. Because Internet Explorer didn't get updated frequently enough, it was exploited to hell and back, and that wasn't good. We had some new browsers come along and rethink the way that things are done, and they were automatically updated. And this really brought the security features and bug fixes to all the end users, but also through this, we also got new feature improvements. So out of this, we got HTML5, we got CSS3, there's like, never in this world do you ever think that there's like a path to like HTTP2 and all these new technologies, but because all these browsers can auto-update, we can actually realistically get those, you know, within months, not years or decades, like before. So we want to bring that model to the back end of the internet through CoreOS. And the main thing that CoreOS does that is different than a lot of other Linux distros is we can do atomic operating system updates. And if you're familiar with the way that Chrome OS is laid out on disk, this looks very familiar to you. Mm-hmm. We actually use some of the open source tools that Chrome OS has developed to do some of this. And so basically you have two partitions, and then you have your data. So you have two different copies of the complete OS, the A and the B partition, and you would boot on the A partition first, and that's your CoreOS version 1, let's say. And then in the background, you're checking up, CoreOS has produced a second update, I should update. The update is written onto the B partition, and a signature is verified first that it's remotely downloaded and written onto the B partition, and you say, all right, it's time to update. The way that CoreOS does this is over a reboot, so you pivot the partitions, and now you're booted on partition B with the new update. And this gets you a lot of nice things. One, because you're doing a reboot, the system comes up in a clean state. If you've done any like live patching to the like loading kernel modules and stuff, all those will be reinitialized. So you're in a really clean state, and then if any of that goes wrong, you already have a known good version of the operating system on the other partition. You can just pivot back. And CoreOS already does this on like 99% of our platforms automatically. So it'll check, there's several different checks that it'll do during boot to make sure everything's going well. If not, you just pivot back. Yes?
What's the underlying tooling you mentioned Chrome OS?
We use their Omaha protocol, which is kind of the method for specifying which version you're on and some other information about what your machine supports. And so that's the communication mechanism. Mm-hmm. And then the update engine is the actual client on the OS that does the update and communicates via Omaha. So we pulled all that in from the Chrome OS team. And then the way that they manage dependencies during the OS build process, we actually use those tools as well.
Thanks.
Yep. So this process gets you an automatically updating OS, and we also have some nice other features, just general ops things. So it's designed to be cross-cloud. Because I didn't mention a very specific thing, those two partitions are actually read-only, and the bits are signed by us, and so you cannot modify them whatsoever. This means that no one's going to get in there and start managing stuff if they're SSH into the server, just giving you a whole lot of consistency. And so cross-cloud, then, you need to be able to do a little bit of configuration to get the machine on the network, mount disks, that type of thing. We make that very easy to do through cloud config, which is a YAML syntax that most of the cloud providers support. And then it's quick rebooting, so we're going to do a lot of reboots here and there to update the operating system, so that's got to be quick. And then for managing at scale, you can pixie boot it and do other advanced stuff, like you run diskless configurations all out of RAM and that type of thing. And because all the container engines and all that stuff are updated by us, we can make sure that they come up in secure ways by default. So that if you're running Docker on CoreOS or you're running Rocket on CoreOS, we've done our best to secure it as much as possible for you. Throughout this process, you're going to need some insight into what's going on. So you've got your thousands of machines out there. You need to know what state they're in as they're updating through your cluster. So in the top here, you can see this is a group of machines that are all 100% up to date. But if they were traveling through those steps, the Omaha protocol has these update pings that it'll send back saying, I just wrote the payload to disk, but I haven't rebooted yet, for example, that type of thing. So they'll move through all these states. And in the bottom, you can see that we have a group called production, and it's got 69 instances in it. This would be a group of your servers, and this, you can break this down however you want. And we on the right-hand side, we have all of the channels. CoreOS ships three channels by default, alpha, beta, stable. You can probably guess how they work. So we'll promote images between them, and then all the machines in that channel are updated automatically. We run these three channels as globally, or you can run it behind your firewall as well and have more control over it. This product is called Core Update, which we use to distribute all the CoreOS updates to all the machines worldwide. You can run the same tool in your data center. So breaking down what our group looks like here, it's attached to the stable channel. Automatic updates are enabled. If you ever ran into a situation internally where you needed to pause the updates, you can do that. And then the update behavior says 10 updates are allowed for every 15 minutes. This is just a rate limit to make sure that you can feel out an update if you have like a diverse set of hardware, for example, and you want to run it through and one of your disk controllers or something is not compatible with our newer kernel or something like that. This gives you an easy way to, you know, not blow through all your machines in 10 minutes and then you're not in a good spot. So that's CoreOS as an overview. I can answer any other questions if you guys are more familiar with it or have more questions, but we're going to move on since we're limited on time. So our second thing is application packaging. You're familiar with containers, so I can breeze through some of this. But the idea is to abstract away the app from the OS. And this is because we want to replace the OS from under you during our update process. So if you're dependent on Python on the host, and more importantly, a specific version of Python on the host, your application is going to break during one of these updates. So containers are the way that we solve this. So you have your tooling to, your developers are managing their own versions of Python or whatever else it is that they need. So what we did is we actually just took all that out from the OS itself. So if you have a traditional distro, kind of looks something like this. On the left, you have all the things that are kind of required to run the system. You've got the kernel against systemd, you need SSH into it, etc. In the middle, you've got your other dependencies, which you may or may not even want. Python, Java, things like OpenSSL. Things like OpenSSL really matter when they start getting out of date. And then on the far right-hand side, you have your actual applications. And this would be if you're running all three on one machine. So CoreOS, we just shifted the line over to the left. So what we still care about are the things it takes to run the machine, because you have to run the machines. But we don't include Python, Java, Nginx, whatever you want. Your developers can manage that stuff themselves and bring it in their containers. You can manage these dependencies, update them as much as you want. So it really makes that nice API boundary between the OS, and we can update that and manage that kind of as a service for you. So I don't have to go through too much of these container benefits, but you know, they protect apps from each other. And you have isolated namespaces and all that that you're familiar with. And so what this looks like for you, the end user, is your base operating system is kind of managed as a service on your hardware by CoreOS. And this is going to get you your container runtimes, things like systemd, new versions of the kernel, new versions of OpenSSL, OpenSSH. So as you know, when all these vulnerabilities that become more and more high profile come out, we patch thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of servers for you. And it's pretty amazing when you you experience this for the first time and you just do nothing and you know your VP or somebody says, hey, are we patched on Heartbleed? You can look in really quick, run the script to check if it is, but you know you already are because you're running CoreOS. More container stuff, moving apps between machines. As we bring down machines for updates, something like Kubernetes or other tooling helps you then say, oh, this is going to go down. Let me proactively move it to a different machine. This helps you also recover from failure. It's nice that you're kind of scale out and you recover. You're the same thing. And then, like I said, we're going to take it down for an update every once in a while as well. And containers are really a great touch point for security in general. So all the namespacing and stuff is great, but also it forces you to kind of produce containers from your CI system. And then you can, that's an easy place for you to add a signature in it so that you know that this container came from you and should be running on your infrastructure. And then you're also storing these containers because you need to deploy them between all your machines. And so if you're scanning those containers at rest for security vulnerabilities, you have a really nice touch point for what am I running that has CVEs in it? And you get to make that choice of, is that a risk you're willing to take or not, or do you need to make an update or move something up in your priority? And then you also have an audit trail. So if there is a CVE in one of your containers, how do you know which 100 machines is this running on? Or are we even vulnerable or not? You really don't know unless you have a container build system. So we have a container build system in registry called Quay. There's a hosted and on-prem version. And it has a security scanner built into it. So we're looking at a container right here with 100 vulnerabilities in it. You can see that the CVEs are listed on the side by severity. And this really helps you get a lot of insight into your containers. And also, you can see CVE right here. It's actually fixed. There's a new package that has already fixed this vulnerability. You could use that as a trigger to rebuild a container or your CI system, do a deployment, or whatever you need to do to fix that problem. We're giving you as much visibility as we can. So I've talked about containers in general. Now I want to step back and take a specific look at Rocket itself. Rocket is a container engine that we started to develop, I guess about a year ago now. And there's two really big points. So it's security-minded and standards-based. And let's talk about standards first. So the container industry is moving really rapidly, and nobody's stepped back and said, what is a container? How do we actually codify what a container is? How do other people know that they're building containers that are going to interoperate with each other? And the answer is that they can't because you haven't written it down yet. We are one of the founding members of an effort called APC, stands for Application Container. And this is a way to kind of have a universal container format. So you need to talk about how something is packaged. How do I build one of these? If I'm a CI platform and I want to build one of these containers, how do I do it? How do I write software to do that? And then how it's downloaded. So if you're running a container engine like Rocket, how do I go out and find these things? And then how is it actually executed? And that could be architecture specific or not. How do you start building the networking and all that type of stuff? And then how do you give people the tools to tweak that? You can also think of it as apt-get for containers. That's probably an easier way. So you can have local mirrors, just like you're used to. Distributed namespace, so you can call these things whatever you'd like. Rocket piggybacks on the DNS namespace. This is really helpful because you can do discovery over the internet. So if you want to run Nginx, you could actually run a container called nginx.com, and Rocket can go out and fetch, okay, where's the cloud storage location of where this container is? Okay, where is its signature stored? Match those two up and then run it. And then you can serve it over plain HTTPS. So there's no complex software needed. You can build software like we have with Quay, but you don't have to do that. You can just use a cloud storage bucket, for example. APC is an independent GitHub organization. We've had a lot of contributions from the community. We're seeing some really great contributions from folks that really deal with these issues, Cloud Foundry, Mesosphere, Google, Red Hat, a bunch of others, kind of all the main players in the kind of next generation infrastructure. And because it actually is a specification, there are some alternate runtimes that all can share the same images. Jetpack, Kerma, and Rocket are three of them that exist right now. Jetpack is for FreeBSD, and the others are for Linux. So that's the specification, and if you guys are passionate about this, I want to encourage you to get involved because we think this stuff really matters, and if you want to have kind of a diverse set of players in this ecosystem and not to be tied to one company or the other or one process or the other, this stuff really matters. And let's walk through some of the Rocket features now. So going after that same principle, Rocket's composable. It's designed to be used under init systems, and you can pick whichever init system you'd like. It should just function like a standard Unix process, so your init system can forward signals to it and that type of thing. And then you can have things like a separate build tool. This is all back from the specification. If you want to use Jenkins to build these versus something else, you know, you're allowed to do that. If you want to build your own tool to do it, you can do that as well. And then it's important to note what it's not. There is no central daemon running here. It feels like a Unix process, so there's no craziness about what it's doing, and most importantly, it doesn't have to run and download stuff as root. Like the Docker daemon is running centrally on your machines, and it's downloading effectively random content from the internet, unverified, as root. This is really just not a security best practice, and so it's one that we've avoided. And then it's not going to become a platform. It's an execution environment. It's a container engine. What it does is execute containers. It's not going to get into explode into doing all these other tools, and we have things that do that for us. So you would plug this into something like Kubernetes instead of making it Kubernetes. And when you look at how something like Rocket versus Docker run, the way that the PIDs are managed, so in systemd, it's gonna you're gonna do a Rocket run, and then it's gonna run your app directly under the Rocket path, and then and the Rocket or the Docker model, your Rocket run is what you would actually use in like a systemd unit, or it's what you run on the command line. But that's really just gonna communicate to the daemon, which is then actually gonna start your app. And where you start running into problems here is the Docker run command is gonna be watched by systemd. And it's going to try to, if it needs to shut it down gracefully or whatever, it's going to send the correct signals. But you have to make sure that that is forwarded into the engine. Now, if the engine dies for whatever reason, or it appears like it's running but it's not, or whatever, you get some sync mismatch there. And so systemd thinks everything's good, so it can't move forward either rescheduling to a different system on the cluster or anything like that, because it thinks it's fine when it's not. There's some other methods to help with this. You have like the health checks and all that. But this is kind of like a fundamental problem that we fixed with Rocket. So what does it look like on the command line? Pretty similar to anything else that you're used to. So here you can see that we're referring to the etcd container by something that looks like a DNS name as well as a version. You can do isolators just like Docker. Interesting to note that these are actually Kubernetes compatible resource isolators, so the same syntax that you use in Kubernetes, piping it directly through here will work. And then you can do networking, post-networking, isolated networks, that type of thing. So this is what it looks like if you're actually on a CoreOS machine and you run systemctl status on a Rocket container. The interesting to note here is the C group slice. So you can see here there's a thing called a stage one, and I'm going to get into that, but it's Rocket has a concept of stages, so it hands off as it goes, and this is a way to kind of do some plugins. And then you can see that we're running another copy of systemd inside of the container. This is to power the pod concept, so you actually have, if you want to have two containers running, systemd is going to manage that and also manage the logs. And if you're thinking, this seems pretty resource intensive, it's actually not, because of the kind of dynamic pages and other stuff that the kernel does to deduplicate memory. So like I said, pods are built in. This is another Kubernetes concept. This is why we think Rocket's going to be perfect for running as a Kubernetes runtime. So containers are deployed together. They can share their same local network and volumes. So we've been working on RocketNetes, which is, it's been a lot of work because as much as the Kubernetes team has tried not to leak Docker abstractions into Kubernetes, it has. So we've been undoing those where we need to. And so we think this is going to make Kubernetes better. We think it's also going to be a more stable way to run it, a more secure way to run it. And we're really excited about it. This effort is about 80% done. I think it's didn't make it into the 1.2. Hopefully it's going to make it into 1.3 release. But we're just cleaning up some stuff. It's available to try now. It's most of the features are there and should work. We're kind of polishing up some of the last things. Another cool feature of Rocket is tunable isolation. So,
my question about,
yes.
You said pods are built in, so how is it built in? Because I'm used to grid files and stop existing D units, actually?
Yeah, so this is actually also built into the application container format, is the, you would construct a pod manifest and say, I want these things to run this way, they communicate this way, they can have an isolated network, that type
of thing.
They
give it to rockets.
Yeah, but you can pull that down as one image. So if you wanted to bundle in your logger, you could do that and run that in every pod, for example, that type of thing. The tunable isolation, so you have your 1,000 machines. There's no way that they're all running the same type of workload. And wouldn't it be nice if you could dial that up and down depending on what you were doing? We have three isolation levels that we're shipping right now, and it's pluggable, so you can make your own. The stage one is where that's done, and I'm going to explain how that works. So, just like a modern actual rocket that goes up into space, it has different stages that are supposed to, they're more performed for doing certain things. They're like task isolated, and we followed that for rocket as well. So stage zero is rocket itself. This is the rocket binary that we ship in CoreOS, and what that does is fetch the ACI, which is an app container image, and it verifies that before writing it to disk. And then it's going to set up the pod file system, unpack the other two stages, and then hand it off to the next stage. This is the execution environment. This is where you could swap your isolation if you wanted to, say, run a container as a VM instead. This is where you could do that. And this is just setting up all the C groups, and it reads your pod manifest, and it's going to tell systemd inspawn to start my two containers that are part of this pod. Then the last step is the exciting one. Those are your containers. So I talked about isolation levels. We ship with three different ones. By default, privileged container, which is kind of your what you're normally used to with a container, and then virtual machine. And there's some different use cases where these are very powerful. Privileged is the stage one we call rocket fly. And this is where you get, you benefit from like the, your container packaging, but you need to drop some of the privileges because you need to do some kind of some extra special operations. So what we do in CoreOS, we just started shipping the kubelet in a rocket container. And the reason we have to do this is it's going to interact with IP tables on the host and all that type of stuff. So it's a little bit special. And you know, there's going to be things out there like that, various monitoring agents or something like that, that you need to drop some of those privileges. The container is all the stuff that you're used to now, running your web apps and your queues and databases, etc. And then you can dial it up to a virtual machine if you really need to. And this is really helpful if you're running like a SaaS CI service and people are uploading code to you and you don't know what's in it. You can run that untrusted code as a VM, or if you have any particular workloads that you're running internally that you're just worried about for whatever reason, you can dial up the VM on that. And the important part is you're sharing the standard packaging, signing, discovery of the app container spec. At all these isolation levels, so you're building these containers all the same, but you can dial it up or down accordingly. So what does it look like to run a pod? Very similar. You're telling it that you're going to run a worker and a sinker. Behind the scenes, the worker, for example, would do its computationally intensive thing, write it to a volume, then the sinker can read that volume and send it off somewhere else, that type of model. Your logger could be in here as well and sending off your logs to a remote location, that type of thing. So that's kind of how Rocket works. Let's talk about some of the unique features. As I kind of talked about earlier, it just really embodies sensible best practices for security. We didn't invent any of this stuff. We're not like, this isn't like rolling your own crypto. We're just applying these like standard best practices that for some reason have not been applied before. And then we have some ease of use things for your operations teams. They're gonna have to run all this stuff. Good example of that is garbage collection. So if you've ever had a disk fill up because you're just creating all these containers, this will help you out. So Rocket GC, you can run this as a cron job or just manually, has a customizable grace period. So you can say, get rid of all machine or all containers older than 30 minutes on this machine. Your whole fleet could be doing this and you can tune that accordingly. Second one is trust tools built in. There's a command for trusting signatures from different locations. So the first one, the storage location, you could say, this is where I store my containers. I trust anything signed with keys that are from that location. You should fetch them over HTTPS and then trust them. You can trust a specific container, in this case, the etcd container discovered from coreos.com, or you can actually trust the signing key itself straight up. And that's the last example. And then if you're deploying your machines at pretty wide scale and you want to say, hey, I only trust these keys, just ship those keys in the image, and then I want to lock down and not trust anything else, this would protect you from somebody, say, SSHing into a box and just doing a rocket trust command manually. You can do that as well. They're just stored on disk. And then the most important one, you can actually fetch ACIs as an unprivileged user. So there's a rocket fetch command. This is pulling down an Alpine Linux from Quay. And then you can run that later on. So that command that's doing the kind of sensitive operation, which is downloading the container and verifying it, it won't have access to hurt your system if something goes wrong there. And then you can run it. Then the last really cool thing is you can actually run Docker containers with Rocket. So this lets you, if you have some build system that's already outputting Docker containers and you want to try out Rocket, you can do that and kind of benefit from these other security practices without changing your images. You can see that we're setting the insecure options flag. This is because the Docker image signing is still kind of new, and they don't do it in a standards-based way, and so we can't do anything with that. And then you can see the Docker :// is how you say this is a Docker image. Last main thing for getting to Giphy, clustering. You're all familiar with Kubernetes now, so you know the clouds equal distributed systems. You have these scale-out workloads, you need to put a bunch of images all over the place. And then business-wise, everybody's goal is Giphy. You want the high availability, you want all the things that were talked about in the last hour. You want these things, you want to be able to ship your applications really quickly, and then at the same time it forces you to automate things. So you're going to bring up these 1,000 machines, 10,000 machines, you're obviously going to automate that. Someone's not running around your data center putting in USB keys to your thousands of machines. And so all of that clustering is based on coordination. And so what do you need coordination for? You need it for leader election if you have a distributed database, and you have to pick your leader and your initial, or you have to handle a node failure. Cluster-wide semaphore is a really cool thing that we do in CoreOS to prevent us from automatically updating all your machines at the same time. So we actually use some consensus there to say that X machines can update. And then dynamic configuration, so if you have timeout settings or cache settings or whatever it is that your application needs, you can fetch that dynamically and then keep it up to date. And then traditional service discovery, so you have your distributed database, does their leader election, you need to go find where the new leader is and start reading from it. So the thing that all of those have in common is that they need to be highly consistent. This means that all the machines need to agree upon these values because they're pretty important. You can't have two leaders, for example. You don't want to be reading or writing to a stale database. And this comes down to it's a pretty hard computer science problem. I don't know if you guys are into that. You know, there's like the CAP theorem and these different consensus algorithms. Who do you turn to? Google has already kind of figured out this problem with their internal version of Chubby. That's backed by the Paxos consensus algorithm. Etcd is backed by Raft, which is very similar. I think it's easier to write the clients is the main thing. That's a little above my expertise. So etcd is a highly available key value store for shared configuration and service discovery. The way it works is you have a leader. These are normally deployed in odd cluster sizes, so 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. This is so that you have a quorum, and so if half, or there is no half of the cluster, so there's always going to be a majority that can keep operations going if there's like a net split, for example. Then the other half can come back in later on and it will be highly consistent for any keys that have been written since then. So these are all streamed out to all of the leader or all the followers from the leader, effectively constantly, and it works pretty well. So why do we even want to build this? So Google solved this internally, but there aren't really any solutions out there that are kind of cloud native, HA, support dynamic reconfiguration. Something like Zookeeper is probably the closest. It's also worth noting when we wrote etcd, console did not exist. We were kind of spearheading this effort into this white space that we saw because all these systems like Kubernetes need this to exist. So what does it look like? It's distributed etcd. So anything that you would store in etcd, random configuration values, you can do that in etcd, and it feels just like a file system. You can have directories, you can watch these directories. Should be pretty simple for you to integrate into your applications. Really quick example, so I want to set foo to bar, then on the other machine, I want to get foo, you get bar. That's kind of the basis for building all these things. Even Kubernetes schedulers just need these tools at a very low level. You can list a directory and get all your config values, for example. Simple interface, HTTP, JSON. You can really easily write clients. Then you can use curl if you want. All these things already exist. We didn't reinvent any of this. Then also, it can save you from reinventing your crypto. You can just reuse your existing TLS infrastructure that you're using for everything else. A cool feature is you can watch value. So this is useful for service discovery. If you have your database leader location, you need to push that out to all of your applications that are consuming it. They can watch this key and get updated immediately on when it changes. Reconfiguration, same thing. Distributed locking, so you need to have all these machines fight to be the leader if there was a problem with the existing leader, and what they can do is all watch the key, and then they'll all get notified, and then all try to write the key, and that's how you take the lock. Cluster scheduler kind of do all of these things to build something like Kubernetes that works so well. Some usage of etcd inside of CoreOS itself. We have a cluster-wide reboot lock. The tool is called Locksmith. And this is what we prevent all of your machines from updating at once inside of your cluster. So you say, I have 5 machines that are allowed to update out of my 100 machines at any time. And so you'll go take, these machines will try to take 5 locks. If there are no locks, they'll just keep retrying. We've also built a distributed init system called Fleet, which somebody said they were using. And this uses etcd to kind of present an entire cluster as a single systemd system. So just like you would start a unit on a systemd system individually, you would submit a unit to Fleet. It would go find a machine to start that unit and then start it. And then Fleet also uses leader election for its scheduler. So it's got a scheduler that can run on any of your nodes that are inside of the Fleet cluster. And so it has to know that there's only one running at a time. This is what Locksmith looks like, Locksmith CTL status. So we say we have one available and one max, so basically nobody is rebooting right now. Say run the reboot command and that machine will start rebooting. The other machine, we run status on it, up, there's no available anymore because machine 7F9 has taken that. And then if we try to reboot, it won't let us. This is the core of the update engine and kind of preventing not all your machines from updating at once. Industry usage of etcd has been really, really amazing. Kubernetes uses it as its backing store. Other kind of tools in the same area, like Cloud Foundry, Mesos, Deus, Docker, are all using etcd in one way or another. And then there's many, many GitHub projects that are using this as well. So we've kind of tackled our three things. All these, we needed to make changes at each one of these levels to get something like Giphy. So let's recap what we have. So CoreOS, we have a minimal secure Linux distribution. It's using containers for application packaging. It's self-updating, and then it has all the distributed system tools to help us run our applications. The tools that we have so far, etcd, Rocket, Docker, and CoreOS itself. Now, if you're thinking, it sounds kind of crazy that someone can automatically update my OS from under me, like, can you do this? Can anybody actually do this? Obviously, we know Google can do this, but is everybody Google? So I wanted to highlight something that you don't typically think of as a workload that would work on this type of thing. The International Securities Exchange is an options exchange that runs on CoreOS and containers. And they presented it at our Tectonic Summit a few months ago. And it's pretty amazing what they've been able to do. So their trading platform is high throughput and then low latency, as you would expect for doing some automated trading. And they're running in production right now on both Bare Metal and Amazon. And they process billions of transactions a day, and at their peak, 150 million requests a second. And it's really cool that these guys are running this platform because it's dollars, right? They're like trading. It matters. It's also dollars for their team. So CoreOS reduced their machine deployment time down to 5 minutes. This keeps them agile. They can react to load, react to failure. And then their operations team was spending 70% of their time running these machines. Like, it's kind of insane when you think about it. We were able to drop that to effectively zero by pushing all that to the CoreOS update process. You know, think about what your team could be doing with that 70%. So they're happy to focus on revenue-generating projects. And they've called this invisible infrastructure. We didn't coin this term. They did because they just don't touch their infrastructure anymore. They just defer it to CoreOS, and they build and manage their containers. And this is Giphy. They've reached it, so it's pretty cool. They've had some nice things to say about it. They're 100% CoreOS and Amazon. 20% of their bare metal is on CoreOS, and they see that rapidly growing over this next year. This video is online on YouTube. It's on the CoreOS website as well if you want to take a look at that and see what they had to say. Some other folks are running CoreOS in production at Viacom, CA, Salesforce, Verizon, many others. So we're getting there. It's actually possible to do this stuff. It's really exciting. So we haven't mentioned a lot about Kubernetes. You've already heard about it. It seems like you know a lot about it. But Kubernetes is our recommended orchestration platform. We tried to build a platform like this called Fleet earlier, and it's really hard. And if you don't have the expertise of Google, not that you're not going to get there, but you're not going to have the richness and the robustness that Kubernetes has. So we're continuing to work on Fleet, but it's more of a smaller scale. It's not going to make it into the 10,000 node range like we want our systems to be. So how are we working with the Kubernetes community? First and foremost, we're doing guides and producing a little bit of tooling. So if you go to our website, we have a bunch of guides on setting up machines manually, setting them up on Amazon. We also have a single machine and multi-node Vagrant repos where you can clone them and play with them on your desktop. We built kubeaws, which is a command line tool for deploying using all the Amazon primitives like CloudFormation on top of CoreOS. And then we've also produced some cloud configs for just generic use cases. This is if you want to install it on kind of a more random VPS provider or something like that. Second major thing we're doing is working, just doing upstream contributions on in a whole bunch of areas. I've only summarized three right here. Rocketnetes, which we talked about. This is our main goal. We want to get Rocket as a runtime there so we can, you know, give a secure option to our customers. We've often been doing some auth and other security work. The main thing is getting OIDC support in kubectl and the API server. This will allow us to plug into another one of our open source projects called DEX that implements OIDC, so then you could federate to an LDAP store or something like that for authentication. And then we've been doing some work on node bring-up, so if you're going to manage 1,000, 10,000 machines, doing all the TLS gets complicated. So this would be a way for the nodes to self-sign and then kind of attest that they are who they are and then join the cluster. Scaling is the last major thing that we've been working on. We just released a blog post a few weeks ago about how we improved the scheduler performance by 15 times. This is just simple stuff that we did, just digging through the code, running benchmarks. We actually had to write a benchmark first. And then, so that got us up to some really promising results on 30,000 nodes, or 30,000 pods on 1,000 nodes. With Kubernetes 1.3, it's going to increase even further. And all this is happening in the special interest group for scaling. We also participate in probably every one of the special interest groups. There's one for different types of things, different scheduling algorithms, running the individual nodes and the kubelet and that type of stuff. So you've heard this word Tectonic mentioned a few times. We are so bought into this entire stack that we're building a product around it called Tectonic, and this is basically combining all of our open source efforts, plus Kubernetes, plus support, and plus some other tools. So if you don't want to track all this stuff upstream, and you don't want to become an expert in Kubernetes, you can purchase a product off the shelf from us that is Giphy. So what this is Kubernetes kind of enhanced. So we've included all of our tools, like Core Update, which I showed, our container registry, Quay, plus 24/7 support. So we've got your back as you're deploying it, or you're running into issues, or you need to scale it, or you just need container advice. And then some enhanced security, which I'll cover in a second. So Quay Enterprise, we looked at this. This is what contained that security scanner. You can run this hosted or on-prem. For Tectonic, it's included on-prem with the assumption that you're going to either run it on like a VPC or on bare metal, we think is going to be a large use case. Tectonic console, which is a Kubernetes console, so you can do CRUD and other operations on replication controllers and services and nodes. This will have more integration with some of the other tooling that we produce in the future. And core update, which we saw before, this can run on cluster as well, so you can keep this completely off the internet and run all of your updates. Distributed trusted computing, I don't know if any of you saw our announcement at Tectonic Summit. This is kind of the what brings it all together. Why do you even want Giphy in the first place? Because you can build a system like this. This basically remotely attests that all of your hardware has come up securely, the operating system is booted securely, the container runtime is configured securely, and then only allow secure machines into the cluster. If they come into your Kubernetes cluster and they're insecure, they can grab your secrets, they can run your applications, they can do God knows what. And this prevents that at the firmware layer through the use of a TPM. So trusted computing, everybody has a device in their pocket. The mobile phones have really kind of skyrocketed usage of this, and they're securing their applications, which look very similar to containers, with TPM devices in your phones. So we're bringing that to the back end of the internet. So basically, you have your four layers of the cluster, starting down at the firmware and the TPM. TPM stands for Trusted Platform Module. This is a little crypto device, very similar to what all your phones have in them for doing their crypto. And what it does is allows you to burn keys in at manufacture time that have some identity information and then can do some signing operations to securely boot the rest of the machines. When you can either order these yourself and say, hey, I want 10,000 TPMs made with my keys in them, or you can trust the keys that are given to by somebody like Dell, for example. I think a lot of servers ship TPMs these days. And then CoreOS Rocket Kubernetes. The most important part, though, is how you hand off the security between each of these layers. So by starting with a trusted root, you can move up the stack. So your customer key, your key is embedded in the firmware of the TPM, and it'll verify some other measurements are correct before booting the OS, like verifying that it was signed from CoreOS itself. The OS would boot. Continuing up the stack, CoreOS then can, since it's in a trusted state, will verify the configuration of the container runtimes, in this case Rocket, and then check that the keys are trusted in the correct location. And then finally, that machine is considered secure. You can do measurements at every layer of it, and what you would say is you would match this to a known profile. So you would say, my super micro servers with this type of RAID controller are trusted, I know that this is good. It takes cryptographic measurements of all these things and then hashes that, and that is your trusted config. So you would do this for your Dell R700s or whatever it is. And this is how you know that only trusted machines and trusted states can join your cluster. Nothing else will run. In fact, you configure it to not boot, for example. All of that is stored in a tamper-proof log inside of the TPM itself, and because of the crypto that it can do, you could actually remotely attest this is true. So you can hit, we're writing a small utility to hit an endpoint that will send that data to a central location, and because of the crypto, you know that it hasn't been tampered with. This is so someone couldn't break in and then clean up the logs, like that type of thing. So what this gets you is you can identify these attacks that have never really been visible before. So you always worry about the script kiddies that are going to come along and hack your web server. But what about like these advanced persistent threats that are digging into your firmware, OS images? If you've got like an OpenStack installation, it's possible to like poison the actual glance image itself. And then things like rootkits that are pretty low level. Because of the tamper-proof log, even if somebody did break into one of these systems, you can at least go and verify what happened, what ran. And so, are all my 1,000 machines vulnerable? Oh, it was only these 100, for example. And then, as I mentioned, you're embedding your own key in the firmware, which is kind of inverting DRM. One of the most famous uses of TPMs to this date has been in Windows laptops to make them only run Windows. And we don't want to do that to you. You have control. It's your hardware. You purchased it. You should be able to say that you do trust CoreOS, but you can trust another provider as well. So you have a new level of security here. This is kind of a game changer, we think, for running large-scale distributed systems in possibly hostile locations as well. So you can think of, like, if you're a CDN provider and you have a lot of points of presence on different continents from where you even have personnel, these machines can't be messed with remotely. And then prevent these invisible attacks to firmware and other systems like that. And then you have an audit log for when things go wrong. Something is going to go wrong. Somebody's going to possibly break out of one of your containers or submit some code or crack a password or whatever it is. You'll at least know what went wrong, so when your VP comes up and says, which of these machines are vulnerable, you can come back with a solid answer. And then we're putting you in control of the cryptographic environment. So that's the journey to Giphy as CoreOS sees it, why we built all these tools, how they're constructed together, and then how we're building a product on top of Kubernetes that gives you a really, really secure runtime for your containers. I want to invite you all to come to CoreOS Fest. It's happening in Berlin, May 9th and 10th. This is the second year that we've run it. And it's a community conference about distributed systems, containers, CoreOS, Kubernetes, kind of all this cloud-native infrastructure. And we're pretty excited about that. You can learn more at coreos.com/fest. The schedules and speakers will be coming out shortly, and unfortunately the pre-sale tickets have ended, but go ahead and pay attention over the next week or so, and we'll announce some more. And I think that's it. So if you guys have any questions, tweet at me, ask them now. Happy to take any questions. Yes?
Yeah, LXD, the container solution of Ubuntu and Docker 1.10, they use SecComp for security reasons to enhance the security of their containers beyond namespace and C groups. Do you support those?
Yes. We have some profiles already shipped, and we also do things like SE Linux as well.
Okay.
For Rocket.
For Rocket.
And Docker. We've configured Docker securely whenever we can as well, so those profiles are in the US as well. Yes?
You mentioned that Kubernetes does a much better job of scheduling and feedbacks. For the use case of node monitoring, where do you recommend that you place those systems? Do you start it through Kubernetes or through Fleet?
One of the other things we're working on with Kubernetes upstream is the concept of self-hosting Kubernetes. So this would mean that you could, a daemon set is like a global unit in Fleet, so that you could actually use Kubernetes to schedule out even Kubernetes itself. You could schedule, the kubelet is a daemon set effectively, and so you can use the same API if you wanted to, say, upgrade all of your kubelets. You could do that through a Kubernetes API. That is what we're pursuing as kind of our installation and update story for Kubernetes itself. So that would work effectively like a global unit in Fleet. You can also run Fleet to run Kubernetes itself. This is a popular thing that we've seen people do. All of our guides do not do that, just to remove some complexity. But if you want to update something as a global unit, very easy to do. Submit it once, and it'll be running everywhere. So you have some options there. Yes?
Paul, at the beginning of your talk, you mentioned that CoreOS needs a reboot for new partition to take effect.
Yes.
Is that reboot up to you, or is CoreOS going to do it by itself?
By default, it does it by itself, but there's also some strategies, reboot strategies, that you can tweak. You can also turn it off. We know that everybody's not there yet, but we recommend you do something to manage it. So there's off, there's etcd lock, which is locksmith and using the cluster. And then you can also just say reboot whenever CoreOS tells me to.
And it does some health check for the underlying hardware when it's working again?
Yeah.
Does it also have a health check for application?
It would not. It would defer that to something like Kubernetes. So it would let Kubernetes say, mark this node for going offline, transfer the jobs, that type of thing. It's basically making sure that, like, the init system comes up correctly and that type of thing. It's mostly like a hardware kernel systemd kind of compatibility. Yes?
Is there a way for me to test out Tectonic on bare metal locally?
Yes. So we have three different plans for Tectonic. We have a starter, which is kind of good for learning Kubernetes, learning for Tectonic and kind of what it brings. That gets you access to the console as well. Then we have a lab environment. So that's really great for getting something up and running either on bare metal or on your Amazon account. Then we have the full enterprise stack, which comes with a lot of our like LDAP integration, the console, Quay, the type of stuff that I talked about. So yeah, all available at Tectonic.com. You can go and sign up. All right, thank you, everybody.